Good evening, everyone. It's an honor to be here with you today, and I'd like to thank the board of the Egyptian Society of Radiology and Nuclear Medicine for inviting me today to be with you, talking about some of the common pediatric emergency we may encounter in our everyday work. It's always a pleasure to be among the contributing in the activities of the Egyptian School of Radiology. And I would like to thank Professor Dr. Hani for his very informative talk about radiation protection and safety and guidelines in imaging, in pediatric imaging in general, because this is one of the problems we encounter every day. A lot of unnecessary, unjustified imaging modalities are being requested for children, exposing them to great amounts of radiation. And this is something which personally makes me very sad, and I even take it sometimes personally. I'd like also to thank our sponsor today, Al Radwan Company, for medical devices, for hosting this event. Of course, you know that the pediatric child, the pediatric age group, they are famous for being active and exploring the environment around them, making them prone to a lot of problems and getting into a lot of trouble. So it's frequent that you would see pediatric emergencies every day, and they may be traumatic or non-traumatic, and they may involve any system of the body, from the head to toe. And this is just one example of one of the extreme cases we've seen in our hospital, our emergency hospital, a few months ago. This baby has been dropped over one of these metal struts used in building, and it was quite a miracle that he survived with minor injuries after having this steel bar crossing through his body, as you can see in this reconstructed CT image. I'll be skipping CNS emergencies because this could be a separate talk. And I'll start by some of the head and neck emergencies, especially that we are starting now the winter season. We would encounter some of these conditions, like epiglottitis. And epiglottitis as itself is imaging is not required per se in epiglottitis, but it's a potential emergency because of the small size of the larynx. And the edema occurring in the epiglottis may obstruct the airway, so it should be addressed quickly. So if imaging is needed, we could do a lateral X-ray of the neck, and we would see this typical appearance of the edematous epiglottis here encroaching on the laryngeal airway, having this characteristic appearance of like a thumbs up or the thumb sign due to the edematous epiglottis. As I said, imaging is not routine, but you have to be familiar with this image, because if the edema is severe and it could close the airway, this would be certainly something to address very quickly. Another issue we would see in this cold weather is laryngotracheal bronchitis, or which is known more common as croup. And these babies with this is a viral infection of the upper respiratory tract, causing some spasm in the upper trachea. Imaging also is not routine, but if the baby is coming for cough and he would do a chest X-ray, you could have a look on the neck, and you would have this characteristic appearance of the trachea with the smooth narrowing and pointing appearance, having the appearance which they call the steeple sign. The steeple is actually, these are the buildings, churches, and some castles would have this pointy structure in these towers, and this is called the steeple. And this is the normal, for comparison, this is the normal appearance of the upper trachea and lower larynx, having this typical shouldering. This is normal appearance, and this is the appearance in cases of croup or laryngotracheal bronchitis. Also, if you do a lateral film, in such cases, you would see some dilatation of the larynx and the hypopharynx. And this is secondary dilatation due to the patient trying to push air into this narrowing of the upper trachea. As I said, although imaging is not routine, but you have to keep familiar with these findings, because a lot of these babies will be presenting or coming for chest X-rays to check for what's the cause of the cough. Another common issue you could see in everyday practice is children swallowing foreign bodies, especially, and these foreign bodies may be food foreign bodies. You know that it's a problem to convince a child to eat something like fish, a food like fish. And you know, most of children don't like fish, and because of these small bones. And as you can see, if it's something like a fish bone in this X-ray, the lateral X-ray of the neck here, we can see this linear shadow representing a fish bone in the pharynx. This is another fish bone here, dislodged in the upper esophagus. Sometimes it's chicken bone, sometimes it's whatever foreign body the baby would swallow. Also, we know that the smaller babies, like toddlers, 2 or 3 years old, they start picking up things from the ground and taking them up to their mouth. And according to the nature of the foreign body, if it's a ready opaque foreign body, then you are lucky, like in these cases. These are foreign bodies which been aspirated into the airway, and you can see this is like a hairpin, and it's been impacted here in the right main bronchus. This is another something like a screw or a metallic foreign body which has been lodged here in the right main bronchus also. And you know that because it's anatomical position, and you know that the right main bronchus is more in line with the trachea, that makes it more prone to for foreign bodies to fall through it. Actually, the problem is if you have a non-ready opaque foreign body aspiration, and this is the more common scenario, and this is the more problematic one. So what we do, and the most common scenario, one of the things one of the nice things about pediatric radiology, you have to always correlate the imaging with the history of the baby. And these babies would usually present by these babies would be sharing their family, their father, their mother, or their brother and sister. During they have a movie night, they would bring some nuts, and these babies are swallowing the nuts. And by chance, one of these nuts get aspirated in the trachea or the main bronchi. And you know, these nuts, like peanuts or whatever nuts or whatever these food particles, are non-ready opaque. So how to deal with such a case? The first or the initial imaging modality is you would do an X-ray of the chest, and you have one of the two scenarios. If the foreign body causes partial obstruction of the main bronchus, for example, like in this case, you would have hyperinflation, some hyperinflation of the hyperinflation of the affected side of the affected lung, or it may cause a complete obstruction of the main bronchus, like in this case, in the left main bronchus here was completely obstructed, then you'd have a total collapse of the lung like this one, and you have hyperinflation of the right one. So the problem is sometimes the chest X-ray is normal, and you have to check if there is a foreign body or not. So what to do? One trick we can do is we can take an X-ray in the decubitus position. You would put the baby on his side and take an X-ray in the decubitus position. Normally, the weight of the mediastinal structures, the heart and the great vessels, in the decubitus position, they push on a normal lung and they can cause its deflation. So if you put the baby like in the right decubitus or the left decubitus, and the lung underneath does not deflate, then there is air trapping in it, pointing to a possible foreign body causing partial obstruction of the airway. Usually these babies are taken to bronchoscopy, but here, this case, this was a baby, she presented for with irritative cough for about 1 month, and the clinician sent her for a CT. He was suspecting that there was something wrong, like a lobar pneumonia or an infection in the lung. And by chance here, we can see that there was a foreign body, an organic foreign body, like a nutshell or something, which was impacted here at the carina. And we did a virtual bronchoscope for this patient, and we can see it. I want to emphasize something. It's not a routine to ask for a CT chest and a suspected foreign body of the airway. But this is just a case for demonstration, which by chance we saw in our institution, and the baby had an irritative cough for about 1 month. baby kept coughing and there was no obvious cause for the cough, and that's why the clinician asked for CT, and by chance we found this foreign body. One of the other things that foreign bodies, of course, they can go to the esophagus, and we can clearly see here that this is baby has swallowed a screw. And in the lateral film is very important here, that you see the screw is behind the tracheal air column. So you know that this is an esophageal foreign body. In the same case here, this is an a baby who swallowed a coin. This is very common that a baby would swallow a coin and would get impacted in the upper esophagus. And the lateral film here is very important, that you can see this is the tracheal air column and the foreign body is posterior to it, denoting that it's an esophageal foreign body. The problem is if this foreign body is an ingested battery, and this is something I'd like to emphasize in this lecture, that this is a common occurrence now with all the technology we have around us and the use of these bottom batteries. The babies would swallow these bottom batteries, and this is an extreme emergency. Please, if you see around the foreign body, don't take it for granted that it's a coin. You have to verify that it's not a button battery. So what's the problem with button batteries here? The button battery, once it's ingested, within a few minutes or a few hours, it goes and chemical reaction gets degraded and causes a chemical reaction and causes a corrosive-like injury to the esophagus. And this is the demonstration here from this paper showing this, this button battery has been placed on this piece of processed meat and left for about half an hour or an hour, and you can see the immediate damage caused by the leakage of the chemicals in this battery. So if it's a bottom battery, this is an emergency that should be addressed immediately. This shouldn't stay in the esophagus for 1 minute. So how would we verify that it's a bottom battery? First of all, in the AP film, this is a coin. This is a coin shadow. You can see that's uniform and almost having a homogeneous density. If you look at the bottom battery, it usually has this double edge in the AP view. And in the lateral view, it would appear having this beveled edge because of the shape of the battery. And this is another example. You know the appearance or the manufacturing of these batteries, they have two metallic discs with an insulator in between. So these are the different shadows. These are several types of bottom batteries, and a coin here is put here for comparison. You would always find this bevel edge in the bottom battery. So if you see a rounded foreign body in the esophagus with a bevel edge, please consider that it's a bottom battery and this is an emergency. You have to address immediately to the pediatrician, and this baby should be taken to endoscopy immediately to remove this foreign body. One other interesting foreign body ingestion. I'm not sure if you are familiar with these toys. These are magnetic toys that become very common these days. And actually, I had a set of these toys for, I bought some for my kids and I used to play with them. They are quite addictive to play with. And these are, as you can see, they look, they have these shiny plastic parts and they have this metallic balls. And you start making shapes with them and fixing them together. So what's the problem with these magnetic, these have strong magnets within them? The problem is that some babies, especially, and it was noticed actually by some clinicians in the United States, that these some babies would swallow these plastic parts. They would consider it like sweets or candy. And usually it was found in autistic patients. They would swallow these parts. So the problem is that he would swallow a part or two or three, and then they will go to different parts of the intestine. And then these magnets start to attract to each other. They cause compression on the bowel wall if they attract, if they are in two different loops. They cause compression in the bowel loop, causing an ischemia to the bowel loop and bowel perforation. So actually, this, this was addressed by some radiologists, and even they enforced it that these toys have an additional warning on their boxes saying that ingestion of multiple magnets may cause bowel perforation and should be addressed immediately. And as you can see here, this is a plain X-ray of a baby who swallowed these magnetic foreign bodies, and they are stacked together because of the attraction forces between the different magnets. And of course, it's a problem if these are in different bowel loops, because they will cause pressure necrosis on the bowel wall and subsequent perforation of the bowel. These are other examples of stacked magnets or multiple ingested magnets in babies. One of the problems also, you can see that if the baby has an infection, upper respiratory tract infection, which has not been addressed, or a severe bacterial infection, he may proceed to having a retropharyngeal abscess. And the initial imaging study we can do here is just a simple lateral X-ray of the spine. And we can see, like in this case, there is an increase in the thickness of the prevertebral space. And we can see gas bubbles here, denoting that there is a gas-forming organism or a gas-forming pathology here. And then we can proceed to a CT showing the extent of the abscess and the size of the abscess. Of course, this is one of the emergencies because of the continuity of the prepharyngeal space with the mediastinum and the extension of the infection down to the chest of causing mediastinitis. So as you can see, I'm not against having CT or doing a CT in a child, but it should be justified, as our dear professor, Dr. Haney, said. If you are going to do an imaging modality for a child or even an adult, it should be justified. Don't just do it for doing it like this. Another common complaint we see in children is cervical lymphadenopathy. This is something I see every day in my practice. A parent would come concerned because the baby has some lumps in his neck. And the first initial study we would do a simple ultrasound and check for the size and shape of the lymph node. Of course, there are various diseases, especially viral infections or bacterial infections, that would cause these enlargement of the lymph node. You have to check for the size, if the size is more than 10 millimeters, and if the shape is preserved or not, and if the hilum is preserved or not, and if there is increased vascularity within the lymph node. These are usually the criteria for active lymphadenopathy. You also should check if there is cystic breakdown or abscess formation in these lymph nodes or not, because I've seen a lot of cases like this. This is another case. The baby had lymphadenopathy, posterior lymphadenopathy, and this is CT performed showing these multiple enhancing lymph nodes, and the pathology, final pathology, was tuberculous lymphadenitis. Moving on to the chest emergencies, as I said, we are starting the winter season, so chest infections are very common, and we have pneumonia. Of course, pneumonia, we have the main organisms for pneumonia are either viral infection or bacterial infection. Viral infections, the X-ray would show these streaky perihilar thickening because of the interstitial edema associated with the viral infection. Or if you have a bacterial infection, you would have a patch or an area of bronchopneumonia. One thing I would like to emphasize is that there is a special type of pneumonia in babies or in infants, which is called the round pneumonia, which would present like a rounded or a rounded shadow like this. So consider in the proper clinical setting that this rounded shadow is not a mass, it could be a round pneumonia, and consider the clinical picture of the patient if he has fever, cough, or suppurative cough. And then on treatment, this resolves and disappears. So consider that the pneumonia in infants may appear as a rounded shadow in the chest like this one, and it's known as round pneumonia. And of course, we have the typical presentation of bacterial pneumonia or bronchopneumonia having a loop predilection and having the typical air bronchograms, or even complicated by effusion, like in this case. Concerning that, I'm a little bit inclined or more interested in neonatal emergencies. These are emergencies that we see also frequently, especially if you are in a setting where you are in contact with a children's hospital or a pediatrician or a very good pediatric service or pediatric surgical service, then you would see a lot of neonatal emergencies. One of the emergencies is the protitled respiratory distress in neonates, which had several causes. One of the main causes of respiratory stress in neonates is the surfactant deficiency disease. And I would like to remind you that this is a disease due to the deficiency of the surfactant produced by type 2 pneumocytes in the alveoli. So what do we have? We have a bilateral symmetrical disease causing, you know, that the surfactant is responsible for the aeration and distension of the alveoli. So now in these cases, you don't have distension of the alveoli. So, and this is a congenital disease. So you have bilateral symmetrical involvement of both lungs. You would have loss of lung volume. You'd have small lungs, and you can see that small lungs, we can have the clue that the lungs are small because they are hypoinflated. You can see the crowding here of the ribs. We would have no air in the alveoli, but the bronchi and the bronchioles and trachea, they have air. So we have this characteristic granular appearance or bilateral symmetrical air bronchograms because of the air in the conductive system or the airways of the both lungs on a background of a collapsed acini. This is the appearance of surfactant deficiency disease. So please remember that's bilateral symmetrical, low lung volumes, granular opacities, or bilateral air bronchograms. And then one interesting thing, if these babies are given the artificial surfactant, which is usually taken by inhalation, then you would have re-inflation of the lung. And this is the example here. This is the baby at the day of life one. And after receiving the artificial surfactant and responding to it very well, we see the day of life two, the great difference between the two X-rays. We have the high, the re-inflation of the lungs, and we have the normal appearance, almost normal appearance of both lungs. Another cause of respiratory distress syndrome is meconium aspiration. And this is seen in full-term babies, usually with prolonged labor or complications, perinatal complication or and prolonged labor. The problem here is that the baby would aspirate meconium. He would pass meconium in the amniotic fluid and aspirate it before he's delivered. So you know the meconium is a very sticky stuff, and it would perform like a foreign body in the airways. So this condition is completely random. The appearance is you may have areas of hyperinflation or areas of collapse in both lungs because the aspiration of meconium is a random process. You may have one lung affected, you have maybe two lungs affected. It's a completely random process. And remember that it occurs in usually in full-term babies with prolonged labor complications in the around the labor process. I forgot to say that the surfactant deficient disease is usually a disease of prematurity. You can see it in premature infant, premature neonates, and meconium aspiration is more seen in full-term infants with problems around the labor or prolonged labor. One of the complications of meconium aspiration or even surfactant deficient disease is during treatment, when you are trying to re-inflate the lung, air leaks may happen. Air may leak outside the normal acini or normal lung into several spaces. If it leaks into the pleura, we would have a pneumothorax. And we can see here, this film is a pneumothorax. So how do we know that there is right pneumothorax? Because these babies are usually in the NICU, the chest X-rays are taken while they are supine. So the air will collect under the anterior chest wall. So if you look very closely here, you would see the increased lucency over the right hemithorax, and you can see the delineation of the mediastinum. This is the shadow of the thymus, the border of the thymus, and this is the right border of the heart. And we can see this increased lucency over the right lung because of the air trapped under the anterior chest wall compared to this normal side where there is no pneumothorax. So this is one of the early signs of pneumothorax. Of course, if it progresses more, we can see here the underlying collapsed lung, and then we can see the jet black air in the pleural space, the typical appearance. Of course, the neonatologist would like to interfere in this stage before reaching this stage because the baby would desaturate very quickly here. As you can see, the left lung is almost collapsed, and these babies desaturate very quickly. So you have to pick up air leaks very early because he would insert chest tube very quickly in such a patient. You wouldn't like to wait until the patient reaches this level of affection. One of the air leaks which may happen, the air leak may happen into the interstitium of the lung itself, Maybe we are familiar with pneumothorax, we are familiar with pneumomediastinum and pneumopericardium. But what if the air leaks into the interstitium of the lung? Like in this case, we can see here, this is called pulmonary interstitial emphysema. And this is one of the emergencies or air leaks which happen in ICU, especially for babies under treatment for about 2 or 3 weeks and on ventilators. If the ventilator setting is not proper or the lung is stiff and not responding to treatment, air would leak into the interstitium of the lung, causing this appearance of pulmonary interstitial emphysema. And the appearance on X-ray, we would have these linear shadows, linear hypodensities that extend from the hilum to the periphery of the lung, being perpendicular on the chest wall. As you can see, these are linear lucency extending all over the lung. It could occur in one lung or both lung. It's completely random. But remember that it might resemble the appearance of an air bronchogram. But remember, there are no air bronchograms in the periphery of the lung. So if you find the air extending up to the chest wall being perpendicular to it, then consider a pulmonary the air leak into the interstitium of the lung, which is known as pulmonary interstitial emphysema. Also, this condition is usually diagnosed after 2 or 3 weeks in the baby being in the ICU, especially if he's on a ventilator. Pulmonary interstitial emphysema is not something congenital you would see in a 1 or 2 day old newborn. These are other examples of air leaks. We have, if you have an air leak into the mediastinum, we have this typical appearance of the thymus here. You know that the thymus, normally we describe it by the sail sign. So just to remember, an air leak into the mediastinum would let this sail blow into the air. يعني, I would say it in Arabic for our Arab speakers. دائما احنا بنقول السيل ساين اللي هو شراع المركب تمام ده الشكل بتاع النورمال ثايموس انما لما بيحصل نيموميدياستاينم الهواء بيهب جوه الشراع ده يخليه يتنفخ فبيدينا المنظر ده اللي هو بنسميه السبينيكر ساين السبينيكر ساين سو ريمبر اتس ا سيل بات اير از بلوينج انتو ات اكسباندينج ات جيفينج ات ذس تيبيكال ابييرنس اند ذس تيبيكال شادو ان ذا ميدياستاينم سو وانس يو سي ذس ابييرنس ريمبر ذات ذس از ان ايرلي ساين اوف pneumomediastinum. And of course, this is an easy one. We can see here the air almost delineating the border of the heart. And this is an appearance of pneumopericardium. And these are all complications of NICU in babies under treatment and on ventilators in the NICU. Of course, abdominal and pelvic emergencies are numerous. I'm sorry if I didn't include trauma because abdominal trauma could be a separate entity, which could be, we could have a dedicated lecture for it. But these are the common emergencies you could say in your everyday practice also, or your clinic. Esophageal atresia, we have several types of esophageal atresia. The common type is either you have a complete esophageal atresia without any connection of the distal esophagus. Esophageal atresia means here that there is no connection between the proximal and distal esophagus, and the distal esophagus is not connected to any other structure, namely the trachea. So what we have here, we have a baby, and usually the attending pediatrician would report that he tried to aspirate fluids from the abdomen or from the stomach of the baby, and then he would say, I couldn't pass an esophageal tube. And as you can see, it's just simple like that. Putting a nasogastric tube and taking an X-ray, you can see here the coiling of the nasogastric tube in the upper esophageal pouch, which is not connected to the distal. And this is complete esophageal atresia. How we know? Because there is no gastric air bubble. There isn't any air in the intestine, actually. And usually, this baby wouldn't need any other imaging. He would be taken by this X-ray alone for corrective surgery. The difficult type actually in esophageal atresia is esophageal atresia with tracheoesophageal fistula. You could have this same appearance, but you would have air in the stomach. And this is the other common type of esophageal atresia with tracheoesophageal fistula. You have the distal part of the esophagus connected to the trachea, and also you put a nasogastric tube. And you can see it coiled here, but you would have a gastric air bubble and air in the bowel, which is leaking from the fistula from the esophagus with the trachea. The most serious one or the difficult one is the H-type vestibule, like in this patient. This patient would usually present with repeated choking and aspiration and repeated chest infection. What we do here is an upper GI contrast study. And please, if you are going to do an upper GI study for this patient, you have to do it under fluoroscopic guidance. This is a patient from our institution, and I performed it under fluoroscopy. As you can see, once we just put about 1 or 2 milliliters of the contrast, it immediately leaked into the trachea and into the right main bronchus. Of course, once I got this image, I don't need to complete the study. I've got my image I need. I've got my diagnosis. I don't need to repeat the films. I don't need to do anything else. Just report immediately to the pediatric surgeon that we have an H-type tracheosurgical fistula. One thing you have to report also, you have to inform the pediatrician in the NICU to take care of the lung of the baby, because even with this minimal amount of diluted contrast leaking into the lung, it could make a hazard of chemical pneumonitis. It could have a hazard of chemical pneumonitis. So once this is one of the things in pediatric imaging. And as Professor Haney said, we do, for radiation doses, we do as low as reasonably achievable considering the radiation dose. Also in pediatric imaging, if you get your diagnosis with the least complication, that's it. This is what we need to do. So if you have an H-type fistula, and this case, I remember, I didn't inject more than 1 or 2 milliliters of contrast. Once I got my image, I stopped the examination immediately and reported to the NICU and the pediatric surgery, and the baby was taken immediately for corrective repair. One other thing I would like also to emphasize, in cases of esophageal atresia, please use a proper size of the NG tube, because I've seen cases where they would use a large NG tube and sometimes they would perforate this upper pouch. And I've seen a case like this. The upper pouch was perforated and the NG tube was proceeded in the posterior mediastinum. And this was something you don't want to do or harm your patient like this, of course. Another common emergency in the neonate is a baby presenting with bilious vomiting in the first 24 hours after delivery. And as you can see, a simple X-ray can do magic. Like in these cases, we took an X-ray for the baby. We see the typical double bubble sign, and there is no distal bowel gas in the abdomen. This baby is diagnosed as duodenal atresia, and he's taken immediately to surgery. Don't need to do a contrast study. There is no need for a contrast study at all, because if you do contrast, it will be a burden on you, burden on the patient, burden on the equipment, burden on everybody, because the contrast is not going anywhere. This other case also of proximal jejunal obstruction, we have what we call the triple bubble sign, and make sure that there is no distal bowel gas. There is no need for a contrast study in this case. He will be taken immediately to surgery by just this X-ray. Okay, so these are common neonatal proximal intestinal obstruction. We see baby presenting with bilious vomiting in the first day of life. The problem comes if you have a double bubble sign like this one, but you find scattered bowel gas. Then you have an incomplete duodenal obstruction, and this is a problem, because there is a potential emergency we have, which is malrotation with midgut bulbus. These babies would have an abnormal mesentery and abnormal rotation of the bowel, and the mesentery is short and twisting around the superior mesenteric artery and vein, and may squeeze them, compromising the blood supply to the small intestine. So what we do here, we do an emergency upper GI contrast study, trying to see if we have a normal rotation of the duodenum or not. And the normal rotation of the duodenum gives the typical C curve, which we are looking for in the upper GI study. Instead, in this case, we have the typical corkscrew appearance of malrotation with midgut bulbus. This is an emergency which should be reported immediately because of the risk of having bowel ischemia or even total bowel loss. And this, if you are very clever and you know what you're looking for, and you've practiced a lot, you can, by ultrasound, you can pick up the typical whirlpool appearance, which is looks like these whirlpools in the sea. You have this twisting appearance of the mesentery around the superior mesenteric artery and vein. And if you do the Doppler, you can see the twisting of the vessels around the center this is the superior mesenteric artery and vein, and usually they are reversed, and you have these bowel, you have these vessels, mesenteric vessels, twisting around them, giving the typical whirlpool sign. This is an emergency. You have to report immediately. Another problem in neonates is the baby failing to pass meconium or having constipation in a neonate. We have several pathologies that may cause this condition. And please, if you have a distal bowel obstruction in a neonate, please perform an enema. Never perform an upper G contrast study for a baby with suspected lower bowel obstruction in a neonate, because of these, I've seen this mistake a lot, and it causes problems more than solving them. So what we do here, we have an X-ray showing multiple dilated bowel loops denoting a distal obstruction. What we do next, we perform an enema. We have the typical appearance of a small unused colon, because this colon is not connected to the ileum. Nothing passed through it during development in the intrauterine life. So it has a small caliber and gives this typical appearance of a small unused colon. And maybe you could see it written in some books as microcolon. And I always emphasize that microcolon is not a diagnosis. It's a sign of that this colon was not used before and nothing passed through it. What we try to do here, we do an enema and we try to push as much as contrast as we can do into distal small bowel. As you can see here, the contrast has stopped at the level of the cecum and nothing is passing into the ileum. So we diagnosed ileal atresia in such cases. The differential diagnosis for small unused colon includes ileal atresia and meconium ileus. How we differentiate these two entities, we try to push the contrast into the distal ileum. If we can push it into the distal ileum and find several failing defects of retained meconium in the bowel, then this is meconium ileus. And the third, a little bit rare diagnosis, but sometimes we encounter, is total colonic aganglionosis, which is one of the extreme forms of Hirschsprung disease. Another emergency is a vomiting child. And these, we see one of the common complaints from mothers and infants under the age of 1 year is my baby is always vomiting. And I'd like to emphasize on one point that gastroesophageal reflux and reflux in babies is very common in the first 6 or first year of life. Usually they are followed up and they do well as long as they are gaining weight and there is no other problems in development. But one of the common things we have to look for is hypertrophic pyloric stenosis. And remember, as I said, you have to correlate the clinical picture and the age of the patient with the complaint presenting. Hypertrophic pyloric stenosis usually occurs in babies after 2 weeks after delivery, by 2 weeks, and extends to about a month or a half, maximum 2 months after delivery. So one of the disappointing things is that you have a baby who is 9 or 10 months old, and you could get a request for, please exclude hypertrophic pyloric stenosis. You've already passed the window or the time where this pathology presents. And the cause is unknown why the muscle hypertrophies. And and there are several theories for why it enlarges and hypertrophies. But remember, the age is between 2 weeks up to about 2 months. And the initial imaging modality we use, and now the most accepted one, is ultrasound. You have to put the ultrasound in the right hypochondrium, look for the gallbladder and look behind the gallbladder. It's usually in a neonate who's crying and moving around. It's difficult to see a normal pylorus, although if you look for it, you will find it. But the hypertrophic pyloric muscle, you cannot miss. You will find this in the longitudinal appearance. You'll find this hypochoic muscle and the hypertrophic muscle, which appears as a hypochoic structure, the hypertrophic mucosa, also because there is hypertrophy of the muscle and mucosa. And sometimes it's been described as like the hot dog, you know, the hot dog sandwich. You'd have this is the bun, which is representing the muscle, and you'd have the mucosa representing the sausage in between the bun. This is the hot dog sign. And in the axial cuts, we have this typical target appearance. And of course, we know the measurements. If the measurement is more than 3 millimeters and of the muscle thickness, single muscle thickness more than 3 millimeters, and if the pyloric canal length is more than 16 millimeters, then you can diagnose hypertrophic pyloric stenosis very easily. Sometimes you do an X-ray. What would you have here? We'd have this distension of the stomach by gases, and then we'd have paucity in the gas beyond the stomach because nothing is passing through the pylorus. You see here this lobulated appearance of the wall of the stomach because of the forcible contraction of the stomach having giving it this appearance. I don't do upper GI contrast study for hypertrophic pyloric stenosis, but it's a waste of time, not necessary exposure, a burden on the patient, a burden on the performing radiologist. And as you can see, ultrasound can, if you are doing it right, it guarantees that you can diagnose this condition very easily. I don't do any upper GI contrast studies anymore for hypertrophic pyloric stenosis. Of course, Professor Haney has described appendicitis. Appendicitis is one of the common abdominal emergencies. We start with an ultrasound. If you are lucky, you can find the distended, non-compressible, blind-ended bowel loop. You know this, we have this template for describing the appendix in the report, appearing as a blind-ended, fluid distended, non-compressible, bowel loop, blind-ended bowel loop in the right hypochondrium. Usually, if there is surrounding omental reaction and fat around it, it makes it easier for picking up the appendicitis. If you are lucky enough, you may find an appendiculate within, which appears like a stone, causing the obstruction. However, appendicitis by ultrasound, the sensitivity and specificity is around 70 to 80%. So, and there are some challenging cases because sometimes it's just appendicitis in the tip of the appendix. So sometimes you don't have these typical clinical picture by ultrasound. Then we could resort for doing a CT. And when you are doing a CT, it's preferred in children that you do it with contrast, because this is one of the issues also I encounter, that they would do sometimes an uncontrast CT for abdominal pain in a child, and then you'd have to repeat it again with contrast or with other preparation, or sometimes from the first, it's not indicated. And we have these typical appearance of the appendix. We can see the enhancing wall due to inflammation, enhanced thickened wall, distension. We have this peri-appendix fat stranding, denoting infection. Of course, you can pick up complications easier, like you have this appendicular collection with gas-forming organism. And these are several appearances of the distended thickened wall appendix and the fat stranding. And this is thickened wall appendix with no typical fat stranding, but this is patient clinically correlated with the findings on the CT and having appendicitis. A differential diagnosis also for abdominal pain in children is mesenteric adenitis. And these, the first imaging modality you do an ultrasound, look for multiple lymph nodes that usually are more than 10 millimeters in thickness. Usually you have to have three or four mesenteric lymph nodes. Usually they are associated with thickening of the distal ileum. Sometimes there is minimal free fluid, and usually these lymph nodes are tender. I have to say that mesenteric lymph nodes in children, you can easily find them by ultrasound and they could be normal. So always check for the size, check for the terminal ileum, check for if there is free fluid. And this is a CT done for a patient, and you can see he's pointing to the appendix, which is normal, and the enlarged mesenteric lymph nodes, and the size is usually more than 10 millimeters in length. Intussusception, this is a common condition causing bloody stool, and we have the, you remember the clinical appearance that the stool is usually stained with blood, and it has this typical appearance of what they call the red currant cherry. Stool, and you have to know that these usually babies, intussusception usually presents in babies starting from 7 or 8 months of age. This is the time when sometimes the mother would start introducing external food to the baby to supplement his breastfeeding. So we know that the most common pathology is because of hypertrophy of the lymphoid tissue in the bowel wall, which would cause a lead point of the intussusception and causing this bowel mess and causing the obstruction. We know that the typical appearance on ultrasound in the transverse image, we have the typical target appearance. In the longitudinal image, we have this mass formed of concentric bowel loop, the intersocipient and the interceptum. And sometimes it's described in some older books by the pseudo-kidney sign, because you know that ultrasound machines, now they are high-resolution machines, and you can see them easily, the concentric bowel loops going into each other. But in older ultrasound machines, when you look at this bowel mass, it really looked like the appearance of the kidney on ultrasound. So if you see the appearance, sometimes it's described as the pseudo-kidney sign. This is an X-ray, actually. And it was taken during performing an emetic reduction of the interception. One of the nice things about interception, and we can serve the patient by as imagers, is we can do, if the interception is very early and it's not neglected, we can attempt doing a reduction of the interception. And there are several methods according to the institution or the place you work in and according to what you are comfortable with. So when I was in the United States, they preferred a pneumatic reduction. And what they do is they insert a catheter or a Foley catheter, and they start pumping air into the colon. As you can see, this is the lead point of the interception, and this is the air in the colon causing this shadow. Actually, it has some risks that if the interception is neglected or there is risk of bowel perforation, air leaking into the peritoneum may cause shock. In my institution at Tampa University, we prefer hydrostatic reduction, and sometimes we follow up the lead point by ultrasound. So we do it usually in conjunction with the surgeon. We do we would place a catheter, and then we instill saline under pressure, and then we would follow up the lead point until it reduces back into the ileum. And this is the preferred method in my institution, doing a hydrostatic reduction for interception. One of the emergencies also you have to be very aware of, especially boys, is testicular torsion. This is, of course, the baby. And consider that testicular torsion can occur in any age, even neonates. And it's sometimes tricky, more tricky in neonates and young infants, because they are liable to what's called an intra-abdominal torsion, not like the typical torsion you see. This is a young child. Testicular torsion is usually seen in infants or young or adolescent child. And usually they present with severe testicular pain, and you would have this vomiting and severe lower abdominal pain. Sometimes testicular torsion is challenging, especially if it's still early. It's challenging in diagnosis. You have to diagnose testicular torsion, and you have a window of about 6 hours to save or salvage the cystis. And sometimes the beam mood changes are not evident, like in this case. You see this is the normal cystis, and this is the left cystis, which is torsion in it. You see that the torsed cystis is hypoechoic, and there is no blood flow within, but this is quite late. You have to pick it up early. So one of the most reliable signs you have to look for is try to follow the cord and see if the cord is twisted on itself like this. If you can see this knot, and you see this swirl sign, which is similar to the midgut volvulus. If you can see this knot in the cord, this is one of the signs by ultrasound, which would make you more confident in the diagnosis of testicular torsion. So try to follow the cord and try to find if there is a knot, and follow it by Doppler. Because if you wait until this stage, usually the testis has been damaged. And of course, there are other associated signs like the thickening of the tunica or the association of free fluid. The important thing also is you have to differentiate between testicular torsion, which will be managed surgically, and epididymal orchitis, which is very common also in young children and adolescents. And one of the distinguishing features, of course, is that in epididymal orchitis, there is hyperemia of the affected testis and the epididymis. Even you would see that the affected testis, the detection of blood flow within the testis is quite challenging sometimes in the pediatric age. But in epididymal orchitis, you'd find the affected testis, the detection of color flow with it is very, very easy. So please consider testicular torsion. Consider also what is a common entity with testicular torsion is the testicular appendage torsion. This is more common than testicular torsion, actually, and present by the almost the same clinical appearance, severe lower testicular and abdominal pain. But here the difference here is that the torsion is happening in the testicular appendage, which is part of its covering near the epididymis, and it appears as this hypoechoic structure, usually related to the upper pole of the testis, and there is no vascularity in it. So consider testicular torsion and testicular appendage torsion. These are two presentations. Actually, testicular appendage torsion, there is no surgical management. It's just follow-up and reassurance. And I've had a case recently, a few months ago, and the baby came for follow-up. The testis is very good. And all what happened is that this structure disappeared after a while, and the testis was completely normal. So consider testicular appendage torsion and differentiate it from testicular torsion. The most reliable sign of testicular torsion is trying to find the whirl or the knot in the cord. In this case, you'll find the cord straight and stretched, and the vascularity within the testis here is preserved. Only this tender structure at the upper pole of the testis. This is a case of testicular appendage torsion. And these are the late sequel of testicular torsion. You'll find the testis is smaller than the other one, and usually it calcifies peripherally. And this is a late appearance of testicular or neglected testicular torsion. One other issue I'd like to address: ovarian torsion in girls, and even if she's a young girl, because I've seen a case, a baby, which was about 2 or 3 years, and she had a neglected ovarian torsion. She lost her ovary because it was not picked up early. The initial diagnostic method, of course, is ultrasound. You would find the ovary is enlarged, hyperechoic, and you'd find the follicles small and peripherally scattered around the enlarged ovary, of course, associated with the clinical appearance of lower abdominal pain, vomiting, severe tenderness in the lower abdomen. MRI can pick up this condition very easy. We can see here, this is the enlarged ovary showing the peripherally scattered small follicles. We can see here the edema of the ovary. And sometimes you would find the appendage or the pedicle of the ovary is twisted. You can see it sometimes by ultrasound and even by MR. And if this case is neglected, you'll find this ovary to be hypointense and black and enlarged also. This is the appearance of ovarian torsion. Please consider it in any baby with lower abdominal pain, even if she is 1 or 2 or 3 years old. Keep it in mind for the differential diagnosis in any female child with lower abdominal pain. Because I've seen a case which was missed, and it was not a nice thing that the baby lost her ovary when she was only 3 years old, one of her ovaries. I'll quickly go through some pediatric extremity emergencies. One of the most common emergencies, you'd find a baby who's coming with his parents complaining from limping. And usually they would ask for an ultrasound of the hip. The clinician would ask for an ultrasound of the hip. What we hear, this is how we put check for transient synovitis of the hip. This condition usually occurs about 2 or 3 weeks after an upper respiratory tract infection. It's something like an autoimmune reaction to the previous infection, where some fluid accumulates in the hip joint. You simply place your superficial probe in line with the femoral neck and look for the capsule of the hip joint. You can see here it's elevated and there is a mild amount of fluid. This is the femoral neck, this is the femoral head and the epiphysis, and this is the capsule elevated here with fluid, and you can easily diagnose transient synovitis of the hip. Consider asking the baby or the parent of the baby about a previous upper respiratory tract infection, which is usually 2 or 3 weeks before the appearance of the condition in the hip. Unfortunately, in the NICU, babies who spend a lot of time in the NICU are susceptible to infections. And one of the nasty infections which may happen is septic arthritis. I've seen a lot of cases. You have here the same condition. This is a baby, the neonate. They will be reporting that the baby is not moving his leg well. And then we do an ultrasound of the hip joint in this neonate. This is the femoral head. And you can see this echogenic turbid fluid surrounding the femoral head by ultrasound. And these babies should be addressed immediately for aspiration of this fluid and drainage of the joint to avoid further damage in the hip joint. This is one of the things you have to address and know very well, septic ulcerative of the hip in neonates. In the babies in the school age, the most problematic disease of the hip joint is Perthes disease, which is a vascular necrosis of the femoral head. And you have to pick it up early. In the early stages, sometimes the imaging findings are very subtle. Maybe a little bit of effusion, just widening of the joint space. You can see in this case here, the femoral head on the left side is smaller than the right one because this case is a little bit delayed. But what you have to look for is this. You can still hear, and this is the stage two of Perthes disease. Look very well on the contour of the femoral head here, and you can see this subtle hypodense line under subcortical line in the femoral head. This is stage two of Perthes disease. This is the bone loss appearing, but you can see that the contour of the head is still intact. You should address it very early because in this stage, what the orthopedic surgeon would do, he would prohibit any weight bearing on this hip. The baby would receive his treatment. Maybe they would do the drilling very early, trying to revascularize this femoral head. You are trying to preserve the shape of the femoral head. You have to pick it up very early before this this necrosis progresses to fragmentation and deformity of the femoral head and a permanent disability for the baby. So this is a thing you have to pick up very early, which is stage two Perthes disease on X-ray. Look for the outline of the femoral head and look for the subcortical hypolucent line. You have to pick it up very early because before progressing to stage three and four, where you have fragmentation and sclerosis of the femoral head. Of course, fractures are very common in children. You have to consider the age of the child and the fracture because in school age children, their bone are softer than adolescent or grown-ups. So the pattern of fracture is different. So in this case here, we have this radius, which is bowed, and this is a fracture actually, which is called a bowing fracture. You only have plastic deformation of the bone. And this is the next stage after you bow the bone pretty much in the ulna here. What happens here, this is a green stick fracture where you have partial fracture of one cortex or both cortices of the bone because the bone is soft. So this is a fracture actually. This is called the bowing fracture. Although you can see any disruption of the bone, but just the bowing or the plastic deformity of the bone, this is considered a fracture. And this is the next stage of fracture, which is green stick fracture. Sometimes you would have these very subtle findings, just the bulge of the cortex, which is known as a torus fracture or a buccal fracture. Sometimes you can have a very fine fracture line. This is known as toddler fracture of the tibia. And this, you can see it's a spiral fracture along the shaft of the tibia. It's a very thin hair-like line fracture. So you have to have a good quality X-ray to pick up these fractures. Sometimes you have fractures involving the epiphysis, and these they have the calcification, the softer Harris calcification of fractures. So we have here a fracture line going through the epiphysis. This is softer Harris fracture. This is type 3 because it involves the epiphysis. Sometimes you'd have involving the epiphysis and metaphysis. And in older children about the age of 10, 11, or 12, we have this famous Salter-Harris type 1 fracture, which occurs in the femoral head, which is known as slipped capital femoral epiphysis. It usually occurs in boys around the age of 10 to 12 years. And usually these boys are a little bit overweight. We have spontaneous Salter-Harris 1 fracture of the femoral head. And you can see here the displacement and the abnormal appearance and angulation of the femoral head with the femoral neck. So this is a case of slipped capital femoral epiphysis of the left hip. In older patients, in the like the high school patients and middle school patients, they are more prone to avulsion injuries. You know, the baby, the children are very active. They are trying to play sports. They all want to be like Mohamed Salah. They play a lot of football. So they are doing a lot of kicking and running, and their bones are much a little bit stronger. But the weak point here is at the connection of the bone and the tendon of the muscle. So they are prone for avulsion fracture. So this baby presented with pain, referring to the right iliac fossa, and with history of playing and running and playing football and kicking. You can see here this avulsed fragment of bone in the anterior superior iliac spine, which is a very common site for avulsion due to the connection of the sartorius muscle with this bone. So please pick up or consider avulsion in children in the middle and high school age. This is avulsion of the patella by the patellar tendon here. You can see the complete transection and avulsion of the patella. Sometimes it could be very evident, like in this case, or sometimes it's very subtle, like this case, only this fragment, small fragment of bone was avulsed from the lower pole of the patella in this baby, but he presented also with pain and history of running and kicking and activity. So consider when doing x-rays for children, you have to do good quality x-ray, know the age of the child, consider his activity, and look for the weak points where the bone may fracture or have avulsion injuries. Some fractures are very certain, like stress fracture. If you have these babies or children, especially high school children who are trying to involve in running activities or marathons, they may have stress fracture, and stress fractures are very subtle. The baby would present with pain in the tibia, and then you may have no or very subtle x-ray findings. And over the course of the disease, if you do follow-up x-rays, you see the stress fracture, which is usually perpendicular to the cortex and associated with perosteal reaction. You can see it after 1 month, very evident. Maybe after 5 days, there is subtle periosteal reaction, and this is one of the common things or common appearances of stress fracture in bone. The last entity is babies also involving in sports activities more than usual. They may have a stress or an overuse injury of their epiphysis. And here, because especially those playing gymnastics, those babies putting abnormal stresses on the epiphysis, and you know that the epiphysis is cartilaginous, highly vascular, then hypertrophy occurs and it grows into the bone and causes a hypertrophy of the physis, and the complication is premature closure or premature injury of the physis may affect the growth and cause deformities of the bone. The last entity I would like to address is non-accidental trauma. Unfortunately, it's under-addressed in Egypt. I hope that the government would address non-accidental trauma. Maybe the pattern of non-accidental trauma or the situations with non-accidental trauma here in Egypt may differ than abroad, but I've seen some cases like this. This is a baby, they have these almost characteristic fractures which occurs at the metaphysis, and it's called metaphyseal fracture. Sometimes these metaphyseal fractures are almost peculiar or almost diagnostic of seen in non-accidental trauma children. Also, you do a chest x-ray for these babies, you find multiple healing rib fractures. And of course, you have CT in the brain. In extreme cases, they have these subdural injury, and even you have brain edema here because of the ischemia which happened. The point is, I've seen a case like this one where the baby had a metaphyseal. He was a 5-year-old baby who had a metaphyseal fracture like this. And when I tried to inquire about the history, I found out that he was working. It was a case of child labor. He was working with a mechanic, and I assumed that this mechanic, maybe he's treating the baby not in a very good condition, or he's hitting him for not following the rules of the work or something like that. So when you see a metaphyseal coronal fracture like this one, consider non-accidental trauma. And I wish this entity would be addressed more by the government to, like in child labor here, should be prohibited and of course regulated by law. The take home points, we see pediatric emergencies in everyday practice. The conditions, as you can see in this presentation, I intended to bring conditions that can be solved by simple imaging techniques. There are a lot of conditions you see here. We don't need to do fancy or very expensive or radiation involved techniques like CT or something. Consider the age and the presentation of the patient. I would like to remind that these are two websites you have to visit. Emergently for pediatrics. This is a recap for what Dr. Hani said. Emergently is a movement where they say you can't use parameters, CT parameters of an adult on a child. So actually this initiative was launched about 12 or 13 years ago. You can even send your machine and the model and make, and they will send you the dedicated pediatric protocols suitable for pediatric patients for your CT machine, for example. And actually the new movement is image wisely for adults. You have to image, you have to choose your imaging modality wisely. And I think one of the drawbacks of the COVID-19 infection last year is the patients doing a lot of unnecessary CT chest, even for adults. This is something which drives me crazy, actually, and makes me very sad. We had a lot of patients doing two or three repeated CTs of the chest, exposing themselves to a lot of radiation without a clear indication. Thank you very much, and I'm sorry for being long. I tried to compress the time and the cases as much as I can. Thank you. Any questions, I'll be glad to answer now.
شكرا لحضرتك دكتور محمد. نشكر دكتور محمد ويعني نحب لو في اي اسئله موجوده يعني نرحب بها سواء في المحاضره الاولى او في الثانيه. استاذن حضرتك يا دكتور هاني لو نستنى 3-4 دقائق لو حد
بالظبط
استاذ الاطباء عنده اي اسئله
بالظبط.
كنت بس حابب بس هنعلن عن مفاجاه. انا هعلن عن مفاجاه ومستر دومين فروم تشاينا ويل اناونس اباوت وان اولسو. انا مع حضراتكم عبد الرحمن الشويخ من شركه الرضوان من إدارة التسويق، وكنت حابب أشكر الجمعية المصرية للأشعة والطب النووي، وأخص بالذكر الأستاذ دكتور طارق الدياسطي، دكتور لواء طبيب دكتور هاني حافظ، أستاذ دكتور عماد شنودة. أشكركم جميعاً على إتاحة الفرصة لشركة الرضوان وشركة أنكي إنها تكون مع حضراتكم النهارده في الويبينار ده، واللي هو يصادف احتفال الشركه بمرور 35 سنه على انشائها، شركه الرضوان وشركه انكي وتعدد توكيلات الشركه. ويسعدنا اننا نقدم لحضراتكم الخدمات بتاعتنا عن طريق فروعنا، المركز الرئيسي بالقاهره، فرع اسكندريه، فرع المنصوره، فرع طنطا، وفرع الزقازيق، وفرع اسيوط. الخبر السار او العرض الخاص اللي احنا بنقدمه لحضراتكم النهارده بمناسبه 35 عام على انشاء الشركه، هو ان على جهاز اشعه مقطعيه موديل اناتوم 32 فيت، هو العدد محدود قوي 12 جهاز قدرنا نحصل عليهم من شركه انكي. والعرض هو يعني حضرتك ممكن تشتري جهاز ب 400,000 جنيه بس وتقسطهم على 3 شهور، والباقي حضرتك تدفعه على ثلاث او اربع او خمس سنين من غير اي يعني من غير ما حضرتك تضيع وقتك في اي اجراءات بنكيه او حاجه. في مندوب من الشركه عندنا ومندوب من البنك هيجي لحضرتك، والاوراق المطلوبه كلها اوراق متوفره بالنسبه لحضراتكم جميعا، يعني اوراق بتبقى موجوده في الدرج عندكم. وهي دي ارقام مسؤولين البيع ومديرين الفروع عندنا، لو حد حابب يعني يكلمهم ويستفيد من هذا العرض.
السلام عليكم استاذ عبد الرحمن. كان في انا شايف بس حد بيسال على اللينك بتاع الريفيرال جايد لاينز، هو اللينك بتاعه اللي هي اي ريفير او الرويال كوليدج اوف راديولوجي، هنلاقي فيه بس هنلاقي فيها يعني الديجيتال اللي هو متساب فري يعني ده القديم اللي هو الديجيتال اللي هي الجايدلاينز القديمة. الجايدلاينز الجديدة ممكن حضراتكم يعني تاخدوها من يعني باشتراك من الرويال كوليدج اوف راديولوجي. وعامة يعني اللي مش عايز يعني يعمل اشتراك، احنا في محاضراتنا دايما احنا يعني عندنا بنبقى شاريين النسخة الأصلية، وبس طبعا ما ينفعش ان احنا ننزلها، لكن احنا في ساعات بناخد سلايدز معينة بنستعين بيها في الحاجات اللي هي حصل فيها تغيير. في حاجات كتيرة ما حصلش تغيير عن النسخة الأولى، وطبعا برضو هتلاقوا في الأمريكان جايدلاينز برضو دي موجودة، بس دي فري خالص لأنها موجودة بتدي ديجري كده على كل إيميجينج موداليتي. برضو الرويال كوليدج أوف راديولوجي السايت بتاعها والآي ريفيرس سايت والآي إي 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 سايت بتاعها الحقيقة مليان بإنفورميشن للبيشنتس والإيديوغرافرز والراديولوجيست والكلينيشنز في كل حاجة. وزي ما قال دكتور محمد برضو اللي هي إيميج وايزلي وإيميج جنتلي، وفي كمان حاجة اسمها يعني في الحاجة اسمها إي جايد دي ممكن تخش عليها برضو. احنا اغلب اعضاء الجمعية المصرية هم اعضاء يعني وزاوت يعني من غير اي يدفعوا اي مصاريف في الجمعية الاوروبية للأشعة، فانت ممكن تخش الجمعية الاوروبية للأشعة وهتلاقي ان في اي جايد. الاي جايد دي بتدي لهم اي مشكلة عندك، بتقول مثلا ان في تروما للريست ودي اعمل فيها مثلا اكس راي ولا سي تي ولا كذا ولا كذا وسن العين كذا والكومبلينت كذا، هم بيدولك الحل اللي انت مفروض تعمله ده. وده بيزود حتى لما بيخش مصريين كتير بيخشوا على السايت ده بيخلينا الحمد لله يعني بيدي ريبيوتيشن كويس لمصر، وبيدي احنا بنعمل كل سنة بندي اكشن بلان بتاع مصر في الاويرنس، ان احنا بنوري ان مصر من الدول الكبيرة اللي هي بتهتم بالراديشن بروتكشن والريفيرال جايدلاينز. فكل المحاضرات اللي احنا بنديها في الاويرنس دي سواء للجمعيات التانية او الجمعية المصرية او في الجمعيات الاخرى في مؤتمرات الجمعيات الاخرى، ده بيدي مصر يعني وضع كبير كاحد الدول الكبيرة في هذا المجال. انا مش عارف الاسئلة، انا في كان دكتور محمد بعت لينكات برضو دكتور محمد.
ايوه فندم، انا كنت حاجة تتكلم كنت بعمل على سيرش وبنزلها للزملاء. في سؤال انا شايفه جاي اللي هو how can I differentiate between types of interception by ultrasound. ده سؤال كويس جدا، بشكر الدكتورة الشيماء. هو في فعلا عندنا نوعين، في اللي هو small bowel interception واللارج بول interception. السمول بول interception ده بنسميه اللي هو الترانزيانت، باسمه كده ترانزيانت small bowel interception. غالبا طبعا احنا عارفين الكورس بتاع اللارج بول، فانا عندي اللارج باول انترسبشن بيبقى لونج الكورس بتاع اللارج باول، واللارج باول انترسبشن اللي هو مثلا الاليوكوليك او الكولوكوليك ده بيبقى بيرمننت ما بيحصلوش ريدكشن لوحده غالبا. انما لو انت تابعتي السمول باول انترسبشن بتلاقيه مثلا في منطقه الجوجينم او الاليوم، بيبقى اكتر شويه في الجوجينم والاليوم، تمام، بتلاقيه ما بين السمول باول. حضرتك لو تابعتيه يعني لازم تطولي بالك عليه شويه، لازم تبصي عليه، هتلاقيه ممكن على بال مثلا ما تبصي على اورجان تاني او بتعملي تشيك على اورجان تاني هتلاقيه ايه اختفى، تمام. لان دي برضو فعلا الموضوع ده انا قابلته لسه في حاله من اسبوعين، ان احد الزملاء شاف سمول باول انترسبشن وكتبه، وبعدين الحاله جات لي تاني يوم مش موجود. فهو احنا بنكتبه ان هو ترانزيانت از لونج از انه ايه انه وانا في نفس السيتنج فك معايا. طيب انا مثلا عملت الاكزامينيشن بتاعي 10 دقائق ربع ساعه للبيشنت مش راضي يفك، ممكن اقعده في الاستراحه شويه لو هو سمول باول يعني انترسبشن، اقعده شويه وادخله مثلا بعدها ربع ساعه تاني او نص ساعه اتاكد انه فك ولا لا. كان معايا حاله الحقيقه يعني تابعناها على يومين، البنت كان عندها ابدومينال بين، ما كانش عندها اكيوت انترستايل اوبستراكشن، الدنيا ما كانتش صعبه قوي، بس لقيت فعلا سمول باول انترسبشن واديتها فولو اب. هي بتعمل فولو اب، الحقيقه كانت محجوزه في المستشفى يعني، وشفتها بعدها ب 24 ساعه فك. فغالبا الترانزيانت سمول باول انترسبشن ده غالبا بيفك وبتبقى الاعراض بتاعته ابسط بكتير، انما اللارج باول اللي هو الاليوكوليك او الكولوكوليك ده دايما هو ده اللي بيجي بريزنت دايما بالريد كارنت جيلي ستول، غالبا ما بيفكش لوحده، ده اللي هو بيحتاج انترفينشن وتدخل. يا رب اكون جاوبت على السؤال يا دكتور.
أنا شايف في سؤال البانكرياتيتس is it common in children؟ الحقيقة التشخيص البانكرياتيتس في children الحقيقة وصل إن هو تقريبا يعني maybe يعني approaching تقريبا الابنسايتس في الادلتس يعني تقريبا قريبين من بعض الحقيقة مش رير قوي في الchildren عن الادلتس. لو دكتور محمد طبعا من خبرته برضو يقدر يقول لنا يعني برضو رأيه في الحالات اللي بتوصل له يعني، لكن هو ده اللي هو الحاجة العالمية يعني.
هو معلش السؤال كان على الابنسايتس ولا البنكرياتيتس دكتور هاني؟ معلش
اكيوت البنكرياتيتس از ات كومن ان تشيلدرن. الحقيقه اللي انا اعرفه الانسيدنس التشيلدرن قريب من الادلتس، وده الحاجه العالميه يعني، لكن برضو من واقع خبرتك ممكن تقول لنا دكتور محمد.
هو حضرتك طبعا البنكرياتيتس في الاطفال حاجه بالاثنين، يا البيبي يكون عنده مشكله اصلا تسبب بنكرياتيتس، انه يكون عنده مثلا انيلر بنكرياس او مشكله في البايل والكلام ده، وده زي ما حضرتك بتقول دكتور هاني بيه هيبقى كده. بس كونسيدر اللي هي البلانت ابر ابدومينال تروما اللي هي بنسميها الهاندل بار انجري، دي من اشهر الاسباب بتاعت البنكرياتيتس في الاطفال، وساعات بتبقى مزد. حضرتك عارف الاطفال بيركبوا عجل او بيلعبوا على اللي هي المونكي بارز وبيقعوا بيقع على الابر ابدومين، يعني حتى ممكن تبقى تريفيال تروما. فطبعا عشان ما فيش فات كفايه الابر بلانت ابدومينال تروما دي مشهوره جدا، ان دي ممكن احد اسباب البنكرياتيتس المشهوره في الاطفال اللي بيسموها الهاندل بار انجري. فده يعني ده اللي ممكن يعني خلي الناس تاخد بالها منه ساعتين. بس بالظبط يعني ممكن ده اللي يزود اللي هو في التروماتيك يعني بالنسبه للتروما. في سؤال عن اللي هو how to describe the findings in the first picture in the slide of pneumonia. هو دلوقتي الفيرال نمونيا بوجه عام او اللي هي البرونكولايتس، يعني انتوا عارفين البرونكولايتس في الاطفال. انا ممكن ارجع السلايد تاني لو تسمحوا لي. البرونكولايتس دي بتبقى فيرال انفكشن في الاطفال، ومعروف ان الفيرال انفكشن بوجه عام ما بتعملش باتشز، هي بتعمل انترستيشيال اديما. يعني عشان كده لما هتوصف بتتوصف انها بتبقى ستريكي، اللي هي السلايد دي يا دكتور اللي كان بيسال. السلايد ده السلايد هنا انا ما عنديش باتش ديفينيت بتاعت نمونيا، كل اللي عندي اللي بسميها الستريكي بيلي هايرال اوباستيز، دي اللي هي بتبقى عامله زي الانترستيشال اديما، لان هو ده اللي هو الابيرنس بتاع الفيرال نمونيا، تبقى في اديما انترستيشال اديما فتبان كستريكي. حتى هم كانت بتتوصف كده لما كانوا بيكتبوا الريبورت، ستريكي بيريهايلر شادوز او اوباستيز، ستريكي يعني مخططه، اللي هي بتمثل السنترال انترستيشن بتاع اللنج، وفي اديما فيبان لي كانها خطوط بيضاء لان ما فيش باتش، ودي بتبقى مع حالات اللي هي البرونكولايتس. فده الوصف بتاعها لو انا هوصفه بالتقريب. يا رب اكون جاوبت على السؤال. طيب في سؤال تاني، does to and fro movement enough for diagnosis of IO؟ طيب هو دلوقتي بس الفكره الانترستيشنال اوبستراكشن احنا بنتكلم على السن قد ايه، يعني السن قد ايه وسببه ايه. تمام. في النيونيتس، لا في النيونيتس انا ما بعتمدش على الالترا ساوند خالص في الانترستيشنال اوبستراكشن، وكده كده الدايجنوزز بتاع الانترستيشنال اوبستراكشن بالالترا ساوند ما هواش احسن حاجه. تمام. انت بتبتدي اول حاجه بالاكس راي الايركت او الاكس راي وات ايفر اللي انت هتعملها للابدومين عشان تشوف في اوبستراكشن ولا لا، والايدج بتاع البيبي قد ايه والهيستوري بتاعه قد ايه. طبعا اشهر سبب للانترستيشنال اوبستراكشن بيكون اللي هو الادهيزيف انترستيشنال اوبستراكشن، خاصه البيبي ده لو كان عنده هيستوري اوف ابدومينال اوبريشن قبل كده او الكلام ده، وساعتها يعني الالترا ساوند هتشوف تو اند فرو ماشي، ده حاجه بس مش تقدر تحدد الليفل. هو بيبقى الجراح عايز يعرف الليفل وسبب الاوبستراكشن ايه. اعتقد ان ده هيبقى ساعتها انديكيشن جاستيفايبل انك تعمل له سي تي لو الحاله فعلا مستدعيه. برضو الدكتور هاني استاذنا برضو ممكن يدي الانبوت بتاعه.
هي طبعا لا شك في الحته دي فعلا، يعني بنشوف ريفيرال مش مظبوط، ان في اطباء كتير فاكرين ان الالترا ساوند يعني ممكن يشخص الانسان اوبستراكشن، وده طبعا مش صح. فيعني بيطلب فحص ملوش لازمه، يمكن الالترا ساوند مش مضر ولا حاجه، لكن بنكلف العيان من غير لازمه ونمشيه في سكه تراك مش مظبوط. فطبعا اول حاجه هي الاكس راي، وبعد كده زي ما قلت دكتور محمد السي تي سكاننج. طبعا طبعا انا يعني طبعا اكيد انتم ملاحظين يعني طبعا يعني انا يعني دكتور محمد يعني غني عن التعريف، ويعني يعني كفي البيدياتريك ايمجينج. لكن انا بقول لك يعني يعني دكتور محمد يقدر يرد على اي حد في البيدياتريك ايمجينج من الاطباء الكلينيشنز مهما كان خبرته وسنه، لانه تخصص في البيدياتريك ايمجينج، وحتى ساعات بيتخصص في جزء معين من البيدياتريك ايمجينج. لان ده انا بقول لكم حتى الشباب الاصغر، دكتور محمد طبعا شاب برضه يعني، لكن الشباب الاصغر من كده ممكن ان هم وانس خلص الماجستير وتخصص في ايمجينج موداليتي معينه، مش هي ما يلاقيش اي غضاضه ان هو يرد على اكبر استاذ في تخصص ما دام هو متخصص في السب سبيشاليتي دي في الاشعه. وده اهميه السب سبيشاليتي في الاشعه، ان انت تقدر ترد على حد طبيب تاني بقاله يمكن 40 سنه بيشتغل في هذا التخصص. لو انت متخصص في جزءك بتاع الاشعه في الحته دي هتقدر ترد عليه وتقدر تفيده، ويحس ان طبيب الاشعه فعلا ليه فايده بالنسبه له، ما يحسش ان هو بيكتب كلام هو عارفه او هو عرفه من سنين.
بشكرك دكتور هاني على الكلام الرائع ده. بس اللي عايز اوضحه بس للدكاتره والزملاء اللي موجودين، النيونيتال انستال اوبستراكشن سبيشال كيس شويه، يعني هو النيونيتال انستال اوبستراكشن سبيشال كيس، والدايجنوزس بتاعه كله يا اكس راي يا كونتراست ستادي. اللي عايز اكد عليه والتيك هوم بوينت، ان انت لو عندك حالات زي اللي انا وريتها لكم، لو هي ديفينيت ديودينال اتريزيا او جوجينال اتريزيا اللي هي دبل او تريبل بابل ساين، ده مش محتاج كونتراست، تمام؟ طيب لقيت ديستال باول اوبستراكشن، اوعى 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 تعمل ابر جي اي، تعمل انما، تمام؟ وهو يعني هو البيبي بيتشخص بانما، لان الموست كومن سيناريو اللي بشوفه يا دكتور هاني، وكان معايا حاله كنت يعني لو الوقت يسمح اوريها، حاله حضرتك ديستال اوبستراكشن طلب لها ابر جي اي كونتراست ستادي، الدياجنوز بتاعها اتاخر 20 يوم لان اتعمل لها فحص ملوش لازمه، فحص ملوش لازمه ولم يساعد البيشنت ولم يساعد وما مشخصناش الحاله. فديستال اوبستراكشن في النيونيت يساوي كونتراست انيما. البروكسيمال اوبستراكشن الحاجه الوحيده اللي الابر جي اي بيفيدني فيها اللي اشوف النورمال روتيشن واشوف اللي هو الايه الميدجت بولفز. اللي بيزعلني فعلا ان بلاقي حالات نيونيتال ديستال اوبستراكشن اللي بتتشخص باكس راي بس او كونتراست ستادي بسيطه ومعمول لها سي تي، يعني دي انا بعتبرها على طول. والله شفتها يا دكتور هاني، يعني كان قدمت مره حاله دبل بابل تعمل لها سي تي، ليه ده انا بعتبر دي كرايم بصراحه، يعني بعتبر ان دي كرايم.
واعتقد الابنسايتس برضو ريكتال، ويعني واعتقد ان يعني ممكن بتالي ريكتال وكمان اورال، يعني ممكن
الحقيقه الابنسايتس يا فندم. الابنسايتس الحقيقه يا فندم عليها برضو كلام، يعني هي حسب الانستتيوشن شغاله ازاي، لان في ناس قال لك ايه، قال لك الاورال هيداري الابندكولس، وفي ناس قالوا يعني مالوش لازمه الاورال وكفايه الاي في، وفي ايفن بعض الناس بيقولوا زود كونتراست. خالد الدكتور هاني يعني لسه كنت قاريها من 3 4 ايام، يعني كنت لسه براجع مع النواب بتوعنا بنتكلم على الابنسايتس، فايفن سام انستتيوشنز بيعمل عشان يشوف اللي هو التيكند ابندكس بدون كونتراست. يعني فدي
الكلام اللي قلته طبعا دكتور محمد ده، يعني طبعا مش كل انستتيوشن شغاله بمزاجها كده، يعني بالمزاج، يعني واحد ليه يعني بيحب الصبغه واحد ما بيحبش الصبغه، لا الكلام ده كله اكوردنج تو ريسيرش، يعني في ريسيرش بيتعمل في كل انستتيوشنز دي، بيشوفوا كم حاله اتشخصت بوزاد كونتراست، كم حاله اتشخصت اورال ولا ريكتال، والكلام ده كله ده ريسيرش، الناس بتتعلم من الريسيرش وبعد كده يقدروا يعملوا جايد لاينز لكل انستتيوشن زي ما هو بيقول.
طيب الاسئله جايه، at many cases of neonate I saw gases at the liver by ultrasound report. This is an emergency. طبعا انا يمكن ما قدمتهاش في المحاضره، بس معنى انك تشوف جاز وصل البورتال فين يبقى انت كده بتتكلم في حاله نيكروتايزنج انتيركولايتس متاخره، تمام؟ يعني ده غالبا بيبي بقاله في الحضانه اسبوعين ثلاثه وعنده مشكله، ودي اللي يوصل لك الجازز للليفر وتشوفها كده، ده نيكروتايزنج انتيركولايتس، ده كان المفروض يتشخص بدري شويه بالاكس راي او الالترا ساوند. الاكس راي تشخيص النيكروتايزنج انتيركولايتس الايرلي بتاعه هو رخم، يعني النيكروتايزنج انتيركولايتس رخم شويه في تشخيصه، انك لما بتعمل سيريال اكس راي للبيبي بتلاقي الباول بتبقى فيتشرلس، يعني تبقى فيتشرلس وفيكسد ما بيتغيرش الباور باترن بتاعها من فيلم لفيلم، تمام؟ طبعا لها ستيجز في الالترا ساوند اللي هي الايرلي ستيج اللي هي في الاول بتبقى هايبريميك بعد كده بتبقى اتروفيك الكلام ده، انما من ضمن برضو ساينس في الاكس راي اللي هي النيوماتوزس انستايناليس، ولو النيوماتوزس انستايناليس اللي هو الاير اللي جوه الوول ده وصل الليفر يبقى احنا كده فعلا وصلنا لمرحله متاخره من اللي هو النيك، ودي غالبا بيبقى طبعا الموربيديتي بتاعتها عاليه قوي. السؤال الثاني، what type of contrast can be used in intracavitary fistula؟ المفروض ان انا بستخدم لو اوزمولر نون ايونيك كونتراست ميديا. الحقيقه الكتاب كافي اللي هو يعني الجايد لاين بتاعي يعني اللي احنا بنستخدم المفروض اللي هي الكونتراست التركيز بتاعها تحت 300 مللي جرام، للاسف مش موجوده هنا في السوق في مصر. تمام، يعني هتلاقي اللو اوزمولر نون ايونيك كونتراست اللي موجوده عندنا في مصر اللي هي 300 و350 او 370 مللي جرام ايودين بير مللي، في حاجات تركيزات اقل من كده دي بتبقى سيوتابل للاطفال دول، فبضطر اشتغل بال 300 ده اقل حاجه عندي، وبضطر اعمل له دايليوشن ايفن اب تو 1/4. واللي اهم من كده ان انا ما بشتغلش بلايند، لازم اشتغل اندر فلوروسكوبيك جايدنس. يعني انا عندي جهاز فلوروسكوبي في الجامعه لازم ابقى شايف الكونتراست رايحه فين. يعني اللقطه اللي انا وريتها لكم الحاله دي اللي انا لما اشتغلتها مجرد ما حقنا ملي لقينا زي ما انت شايف التراكيه راح جايه منوره، وطبعا عندي الجهاز بياخد فلورو وسيريال، خدت اللقطه بتاعتي وقفلت الفحص على كده. فده بالنسبه للسؤال اللي هو بتاع الكونتراست.
يعني اعتقد كده لو يعني الاسئله تمام عشان الناس بقى اللي عايز يتغدى واللي عايز يعني يشوف حاجه تانية، احنا طبعا على الرحب والسعه في اي استفسار يعني مني او من دكتور محمد على حتى يعني تليفوناتنا اعتقد موجوده مع ناس كتير وعلى السايت بتاع الجمعيه، فيعني تشرفونا في اي وقت ونتمنى تكونوا استفدتوا من الكلام ده، وياريت تبعتوا لنا برضو ايه المواضيع اللي انتوا انترستد فيها للمدارس القادمة بإذن الله، اللي احنا هنزود عدد المدارس اكتر. كنا بنعمل مدرسة كل شهرين، دلوقتي نتيجة زوم ميتنج دي انهم يعني ما بنعملش قوي اون سايت او فيس تو فيس، فبنزود الزوم ميتنجز على قد ما نقدر لغاية ان شاء الله ما نعمل حاجات هانس اون قريب لما الدنيا ان شاء الله تهدى شوية بإذن الله. وشكرا، ونتمنى دايما تكونوا معنا دايما في كل الدورات بتاعتنا ان شاء الله.
شكرا لحضرتك دكتور هاني، شكرا دكتور محمد، كان مستر دومين كان حابب يشكر حضراتكم.
تفضل
يدخل يشارك يشكر حضراتكم.
شرف
مستر دومين.
مستر دومين
لو
ويلكم مستر دومين.
ثانك يو دكتور هاني، ثانك يو فور يور اكسلنتس presentation and the speech. And so, ladies and gentlemen, I'm Domin from Enki. So first of all, I would like to say thank you to Dr. Hani and Dr. Muhammad. Thank you very much for your excellent presentation and speech.
Thank you.
And then I'd like to thank you all for your time to take part in this special and meaningful conference. Hope in the future we could have more chance to stay together to share our radiology experience. And today, I have another very good news for all. With our continuous effort from my colleagues, our most advanced 256-slice CT scanner now is ready. Egypt will be our first station to launch this excellent product overseas. So now, let my colleague to guide you to know more characters about our Anthem S800. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you all. Best wishes, and see you again in our future School of Radiologists.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello, Dr. Hani. I'm sorry. My colleagues will play a video about our launching.
Okay.
About our launching conference.
Yeah.
Just one moment.
You're welcome. Please
thank
do.
You so much.